see everybody here this morning. Just want to welcome you guys and appreciate you worshiping with us this morning. Do we have any new visitors with us today? Nope, always good to see familiar faces. So again, appreciate you guys worshiping with us. Really excited to let you guys know, so we're going to have our own chapel prayer day today. So after this service, right outside the back, where we do our fellowship for some donuts and coffee and all the good stuff, we have representatives from several ministries that we offer here at the church. So again, it would be a great opportunity to get familiarized with opportunities for ministries. Also, Awana registration is still open, and it kicks off next Sunday, so also always a great opportunity for the youth. And if you're interested in doing some teaching, Sunday school teachers, if God has given you that talent, and you want to share that with others, please contact Carl if you're interested in doing that. Again, always a great youth ministry we have here, and you can see the information for the Facebook page and the email address if you're interested in that. And of course, I highly encourage you guys to get involved with the two Sunday school classes that we have right now. One, we have studying Genesis up at Frontier Chapel in room 158, and that is in person and also is online via Zoom. And they have the address on there. And then also the second Sunday school class is currently only on Zoom right now. It's the Walking with God in the Desert video study, and then they will resume going back in person on September 12th. Again, also, just want to remind that after this, right out back, it'll be a great time for some fellowship, coffee, donuts, and it's always great to see everybody's smiling faces and just get to know one another and things of that nature. And then also, if you've got anything you would like to share, I would encourage you to fill out the connection card on here and put it in the offering plate when it gets passed around. And with that, if you guys would go ahead and please stand for singing the next one.
Thank you. for the sermon. Pray for Jeff as he comes to bring us, and we can continue through the creed and the concept of judgment. Thank you that as we stand in Christ, we are able to do that. But it is a reminder that he is the sufficiency of our life. For care of our souls, for care of our bodies and our health, for lifting up the prayer of our community and those around us, those we love and care deeply about. So as we pray for each other, as we continue to journey our way through the pandemic, Lord, let your safety and protection be with us. Lord, for the normal cares and concerns, there's a lot of individuals and us deal with issues around cancer and other health issues. Be the strength of our bodies, but Lord, help us remember most and foremost that you are the strength of our soul. Father, as a nation, we gather, as many congregations have gathered around this morning to worship and lift your name on high, we pray for the national issues and concerns. We pray for our sons and daughters, our brothers and sisters who serve overseas, particularly those in Afghanistan, that your safety be with them, that people are able to be evacuated to safety, that your protection exists even in the midst of that. Father, for those in great need, whether it be our friends and families that may live in Tennessee in the flood, those overseas in Haiti recovering from the earth, Haiti recovering from the earthquake, may your grace be ever present. As organizations respond and send help, Lord, let your protection be with them for the saving of life. May it be a witness of you and your faithfulness. May your grace be demonstrated in such a way that it's unmistakable that it's your hand at work, even in the midst of disaster, to bring hope, to bring that illustration of salvation, that you're a loving God filled with mercy and compassion. So, Father, we thank you and celebrate that. Lord, we recognize our need for you. We come with humility to confess that we need you every hour, Lord. We need you in our life. So, Father, thank you for hearing our prayers, and we have access to the throne of grace through Jesus Christ. Father, thank you that we can gather as a community to pray and to come together. And Lord, let us unite our hearts together as we pray for each other and one another, and let us unite around the Lord's prayer as we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us once again, we are thankful for your generosity and faithfulness to us. Father, let us express that to being a people who are known as generous and a gift to you. Not because we have to, but because it is an act of worship and a desire for our heart. As Paul says, let us be joyful givers. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Please remain standing.
This morning we have two solemn passages of Scripture. The first is 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 through 10. 2 Corinthians 5, 6 through 10. So we are always of good courage. We know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. But we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please Him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Second passage of Scripture is Revelation. Chapter 20, right at the back of your Bible. Verse 11 through 15. Revelation chapter 20, verses 11 through 15. Then I saw a great white throne, and him who was seated on it. From his presence, earth and sky fled away, and no place was found for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Then another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books, according to what they had done. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it. Death and Hades gave up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one of them, according to what they had done. The death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. May God add his blessing to the reading, hearing, and understanding of his word. You may be seated.
Certainly, what a very unique turning point we get to today in light of the scriptures that have been read. Those of you who have been following along and perhaps been doing your own studies, understand that up to this point, everything that we have declared in the Creed is past tense. God created. Jesus was born of a virgin. He suffered, was crucified, died, and buried. Everything so far has been in the past. Now we move to a point of the creed where we are proclaiming that which is to come. We are expressing our faith, our belief in that which has not yet happened, but we are proclaiming it will come. What a glorious truth this is, as we will look at here this morning. But before we do, I invite you to join with me as we pray and seek God's face. Lord, we come before you today, for we are in need of you. We are in need of your grace, the illumination The end of something is never good, whether it's a cup of coffee, or whether it is the very end of the money in your bank account, or the end of that Netflix season, and now you've got to wait a whole other year to see what's going to happen. The end of something is never good. What about the end of life? The end of life. We have been talking in the Apostles' Creed of our proclamation of our hope, and that is in Jesus Christ, the one who suffered, the one who was crucified, the one who died, the one who descended, the one who rose, and did all of this for our salvation, that we may know him, be found in him, and have hope in this life, but also the life to come. But what is that end of life? What will it be like? Will it just be ushered into a realm of nothingness, which many atheists believe and articulate, that there is nothing to be had, nothing to be enjoyed, that life as we know it will just end? You've probably heard the phrase that people would say, that our bodies are just eaten by worms, and then that is it. Will there be something different? This is what we proclaim in the Apostles' Creed, this great, glorious, dreadful, but joyful biblical truth of a great day of accountability, of a judgment day. But what will that day be like? That's what we want to look at this morning. So that when we stand and we proclaim that though he has ascended and he is seated at the right hand of God, that he will return to judge the living and the dead. What will that day be like? Let me just say up front, the coming day of judgment is not a day of fear for those who are in Christ. Let me emphasize that again. If you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that great day of judgment that we are awaiting, the coming of the Lord, coming to judge, is not a day of fear for those of us who are in Christ. It's a great day of awe. It's a great day of joy. Here's what I want you to understand as we look at this. I want us to understand the what of the events. We won't get into the why. We really don't have time to, I say the why, but the when. We really won't have time to get into the when. Those of you, I would encourage you to look at, there's a lot of books like the four views of the end times, whether that be the millennial, whether that be the tribulation. You can be pre-trib, post-trib, mid-trib. Is Jesus coming back before the 1,000 years? Is he coming back afterwards? Will there even be a 1,000-year reign? All that is the when. We're simply focused this morning on the what. There are two simple truths that we will see. One is that Jesus is going to return. And then secondly, Jesus is coming as a judge. He will come and judge both the living and the dead. So as we look at our text and we look at this thought here today, we want to examine those two simple truths, and that is Jesus is coming again, and Jesus is coming as judge. And then I will conclude by providing some action steps for us. And I framed them in this way: things for us to think about, things for us to feel, and things for us to do. But before we begin looking at these simple truths, let me just provide three caveats here. And the first is this, is that judgment is hard for us to think about. When we think of God, we rightfully and biblically see God as the God of love, the God of grace, the God of mercy, the God who so loved that he gave his one and only begotten Son. God is a just God. He is coming to judge. That role, that work of judgment does not lessen his love, his mercy, or his grace, but rather it is an outpouring of his character. God is a holy and a righteous God. And no sin, no amount of unrighteousness can enter into the presence of God. And that separation from that which is holy and that which is unholy is the judgment. So though we do not like to think of judgment, and it is hard for us to understand, it is an expression of God's holy and his righteous character. And then secondly, let me say this as a caveat. Though we will talk about judgment, we don't want to lose sight of the horrors of hell. We will talk about judgment as it is listed there in Revelation chapter 20, as is read Matthew chapter 25. And we will talk about an event that will come. Well, God, Jesus Christ, will separate those who are his from those who are not, and they will be cast into a place of darkness and a place of eternal torment. We will talk about that as an event. May we hear it with tears in our eyes that there will be those who will go through this life and never know Jesus as Lord and Savior. We talk about it, and the horror of hell is real, although we talk about it as an event. And then, as I said already, let me mention this third caveat, and that is we will talk about the what of that judgment day, not the when. Not the when. I encourage you to do that study on your own. Perhaps the Lord in his grace will allow us in the days to come maybe to speak toward that. But today, as we talk about the creed and our declaration that he will come again and judge the living and dead, we are focusing on so let's begin looking at these two simple truths that we declare. First and foremost, Jesus is coming again. The second coming of Christ is listed over 300 verses in the New Testament. That means that for every one of every 13 verses in the New Testament deals with some aspect of our Lord's return to earth. It is so central to the New Testament that Christians everywhere believe that there is coming a day that Jesus will return. And even though we may differ as to when that will take place, we are united on the simple truth that Jesus will return. Jesus says in John chapter 14, verse 3, I will come again. As we looked at a few weeks ago, in Acts chapter 1, verse 10 to 11, we read there twice this word, the sameness of Jesus. Let me read this for you. Acts chapter 1, verses 10 to 11. They were looking intently into the sky as he was going, and suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. And men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? Notice what he says. The same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back again in the same way you have seen him go into heaven. On two occasions, he is emphasizing this word of the sameness. And this is telling us a very crucial aspect about the second coming. That it is the same Jesus who left that will be coming back, and he will come back in the same way. That's the reason why we describe it in five ways, that the coming of Jesus will be personally. It will not be someone representing Jesus. It will not be Michael the archangel. It will be Jesus himself that will return. It will be literally. This won't be a vision. It won't be a dream. Just as he ascended in glory, he will return in glory. And it will be visible, it will be bodily, as they looked and saw him go. The angel says, you will see him return. The same Jesus will return in like manner. And if we look elsewhere, such as in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, we understand that that return will also be sudden and unexpected. Like a thief in the night, the scriptures declare. The only thing that we are uncertain about is the when. But the simple truth is that Jesus is coming again. His first coming was as a suffering servant. His second will be as a conquering king, coming to establish this throne and usher in judgment. His first coming, Jesus arrived in the most humble of circumstances. But in his second, he will come with the armies from heaven. His first coming was in humility to bring redemption. And his second coming will be in glory, bringing God's redemptive purposes as he executes his judgment upon mankind. Even though that is a terrifying thing to think about, the apostle reminds us that this is known as our blessing. Jesus' return is our blessed hope. You know, there were a time when many of our hymns, those, and I'm sure you can look at those in our pew, and you will see them there, but many of our hymns were speaking of that return. They were speaking of a home in heaven. They were speaking of that time at the end. And they were doing so as a means of hope and encouragement for the body of Christ. It is our blessed hope to know that this is not the end. That the wicked will not have the final say. That even though I endure and I lean upon God, and maybe I don't see the outcome of which I hope for, that there will be a day that I will be with him in God's righteousness. Will reign supreme. It is our blessed hope this coming. Let me ask you, is it your blessed hope? Listen, it is so easy in this life, in this world, to place our hope in things that are not worthy of our hope. You know, we do that. We say to ourselves that life will be better once I retire. Young people, maybe you say, life will be better once I get out of home or get away from home and get out of my home. We might say that life will be better once I graduate and I move on to another assignment or maybe get that next promotion. Or maybe we place hope in a vaccine. To say that this is the thing that's going to make everything okay. Life will get back to the way we know. Maybe we place our hope in a medical procedure. In the medicine that the doctor says my body needs. The only thing that is worthy of our hope is the Lord Jesus Christ. And his return is the blessed hope of believers. Let me ask you again, is that your blessed hope? If not, I want to encourage you to place your eyes, your heart, and your mind upon that biblical truth that even in the midst of your pain, your sorrow, the chaos, Jesus is coming again. If you just simply stay true and faithful to the straight and narrow that he is calling you to, it is not in vain, for Jesus is coming again. He indeed is our blessed hope. Jesus is coming again, but secondly, we know that he is coming, how? He is coming as a judge. He is coming to execute righteous judgment. We know that he is coming to judge as we declare and decree the living and the dead. That phrase is listed four times in the scripture. Acts 10:42 tells us how God has appointed Jesus as this judge of the living and the dead. 2 Timothy 4:1, where charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead. Romans 14:9, for to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and the living. And 1 Peter 4:5, but they will give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. And it's interesting, if you look at the context of these scriptures, the judging of the living and the dead is not just for unbelievers. The judging of the living and the dead is for the righteous as well. So as we look at the scripture as a whole, coming to understand that Jesus is coming again and he is coming as judge, we have to know that in the Bible we see three descriptions of a coming judgment. Three descriptions of a coming judgment. One of those we know of as the judgment seat of Christ, where the believers will stand before God and they will be judged accordingly, as the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 10, one of the verses that was read for us this morning. But we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Judgment seat of Christ. There's another judgment that we know of as the great white throne judgment. That was read for us, as we know, in Revelation chapter 20. We read at the very end of verse 12, and the dead were judged by what was written in the books according to what they had done. And then later on in verse 13, and they were judged, each one of them, according to what they had done. In verse 15, and anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, and was thrown into the lake of fire. The great white throne. You see that in verse 11, then I saw a great white throne. And so we have this depiction of the judgment seat of Christ. We have this depiction of the great white throne. And then in Matthew 25, we have this image of the separation of the sheep and the goats. And this is the separation of the sheep and the goats, the indication here, the sheep of the followers of Christ and the goats which are not, and a separation of those two, and referred to as, again, a judgment of the sheep and the goats. We have these three judgments that are depicted in scriptures, and what I refer to as two measurements of judgment. Two measurements of judgment. What would that be? Well, we see this primarily and more clearly in the scripture of Revelation chapter 20. So that's where I want to focus our time now. Revelation chapter 20, verses 11 to 15. So as we look at this text, and again, what we see written here as a great white throne judgment, I had mentioned two measurements. Notice in the text here that there are two books. Verse 12, and I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books, plural, were opened. Then another book was opened. And notice we get more information about this book, which is the book of life. And previously in Revelation chapter 13:8, we are told that this is the book of life of the Lamb who was slain. Right? What is he talking about? That this is the book of which those who have been redeemed, those who are clothed in the righteousness of Christ, those who have been saved, are in this book. So we have these two books. One clearly having a book of life indicating those who are born again. And then these plural books, what are those? We get a picture of that as we look again at the very end of verse 12. And notice how the dead were judged by what was written in the books. Notice what it says. And yet also notice that this phrase is used twice. According to what they had done. So you have a judgment based upon one book, which is a book of life. The Lamb who had been slain, so this is a book. which the redeemed are listed, and then you have a set of books that seem to record deeds, things that were done. I want you to notice this as well. If you go to Matthew chapter 25, and in that context of the separating of the sheep and the goats, and Jesus says to the sheep, those on his right, you may enter in. But then, how does he explain that? He goes on to talk about how when he was hungry, they fed him, when he was thirsty, they gave him something to drink, when he was in prison, they came and visited on him. It was, again, by deeds done in the flesh. Notice also, in what we refer to as the judgment seat of Christ, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, again, focusing on verse 10, for we will all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what? What he has done in the body. So there seems to be, on that great judgment day, there will be a set of books, one book simply having the list of those who are redeemed, the book of life, and another set of books that is recording the deeds that have been done in the body, in the flesh. Three judgments, which I believe all speak of one judgment. I believe that here at this moment, when Christ comes, he descends in his glory, and he is enthroned here as king, and he is sitting on that throne. Those who are living, as well as the dead, will be resurrected, and they will be judged. Those who know Christ as their Lord and Savior will enter into their place of rest. Those who do not will enter into the place of utter darkness and be forever separated from the Father and in the place that the Bible tells us is the place of torment. What do you make of this, what they have done in the body? What they have done in the body. Well, what we are not to take from it is that our salvation, our entry into the Lamb's Book of Life, is not gained by what we do in the body. The scriptures are very clear in that. Right? Salvation is by grace through faith. Scripture alone says that it is not by any works of righteousness that we have done. Right? So it's very clear that's not what he's talking about. I think the best way to understand this is looking at James chapter 2, which is another very difficult passage. James chapter 2, remember, James proclaims there for us, right, that faith without works is dead. And then notice what he says. Some of you will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you what? I will show you my faith by my works. And so those of you who are with us, and remember when we studied this portion of the book of James, what we're understanding is James is looking at faith as a demonstration. It is a horizontal expression of a vertical reality. So you may say, as he goes on in James, to say, you believe in the devil, or you believe in God, but even the devil, even the demons believe. The implication is that are not saved. So belief alone does not mean much. It is belief that is such a belief that transforms life that is demonstrated in how we live. And that's the principle of what he's saying here. What we see here of those who have these deeds done in the body are indicative of those who have faith. It is those who have been transformed. As one scholar said, our deeds confirm that our names are in the book and should be in the book. That is, they confirm that we trust Christ and are united to him our deeds are the fruit of our faith and union with Christ. Union with Him. Three mentions of judgment. Certainly one that will be upon the living and the dead. Two measurements. Measurements, faith in Christ, and the measurements of deeds done in the flesh. Bottom line, Jesus is coming, and He is coming to judge. So what? What are we to think, to feel, and to do as we await Jesus' return and subsequent judgment? What are we to think, feel, and do? First, no one will get away with evil. Everyone has a day of accountability awaiting us. Everyone. The judgment of God assures us that God will not ultimately allow wickedness to prosper. We live in a world to where it's so easy to see those who engage in wickedness, who engage in things that just bring horror to our hearts and our minds, and they seemingly get away with it. They live their life to the very end and seemingly in joy and in full pleasure. But the whole idea that Jesus is coming again and coming as a judge reminds us, should cause us to think and remember that no one gets away. That there will be a judgment that will come. As Jesus says, I tell you, one day the judgment of people, they will give account for every careless word they speak. No one will get away with evil. Secondly, what should we feel? What should we feel? Understanding that Jesus is coming again and He's coming to execute judgment. The separating of the sheep and the goats, the righteous from the unrighteous. In the words of John Piper, it should send us trembling with joy to the cross of Jesus and to the grace of God which holds on to us. That is the reason why I said from the beginning, the day of judgment that is to come should not be a day of fear for us. For those who are in Christ, we will inherit our great reward, and that is to enter into the presence of Almighty God. That is to see Jesus, to be in His presence, enthroned as King here. And it ought to bring us great joy. Trembling, yes, because of the awe of God on His throne, in His glory, and executing judgment. But joy, because the judgment that we will receive as those who are in Christ is not based upon our works and the means of allowing us to enter the kingdom of God. For that has already been judged upon the cross. When Jesus was upon the cross, the wrath of God was upon Him, and the judgment that we deserve to be eternally separated from Him, Jesus experienced on the cross. That is our glory. That is our glory. And when we think and proclaim He's coming, and He's coming to judge, joy should well up in our souls. Because we know that we, in Christ, have already been judged, and have been judged righteous. Have been judged forgiven, have been judged a joint heir with Christ. Great joy should well up in our soul as we praise God for what is ours in Him. And then thirdly, what we should think is that there will be a judgment day coming and no one will escape it. What we should feel is the joy that is ours in Christ and the righteous judgment that He has procured for us. And what we should do, what we should do? faithfully proclaim the gospel. If there's coming a day where God will separate those who know Him and those who do not, then our task, our responsibility as those who live, those who know Him, is to be a faithful witness for Him. That is the whole argument that Jesus Himself makes in Matthew chapter 24. The gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. We see the same thing in Acts chapter 1. When Jesus is reminding them, the angels are reminding them of the promise of the Spirit to come. And they said to wait in Jerusalem for that. They're confused. They're wanting to know, is that when the kingdom will be restored? And you get this feeling as if what's being said is that's not the priority. That's what we read in Acts 1:8, that you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. Power for what reason? So that you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria to the uttermost ends of the earth. Let the lost may hear. Here's our simple truth. When we reach the end, it really is not good, right? We want things to last. We want things to continue. We don't like it when it comes to an end. And sometimes we take that thought of the end of life, the end of the world, and it brings fear, it makes us tremble, it makes us worry, it makes us doubt. But if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the end, the day of judgment, the coming of Christ is not a time of fear. It is a time of great joy, as we will be united in Him and spared the wrath of God because of the righteousness He procured on the cross. So the coming day of judgment is not a day of fear for those of us who are in Christ. May we be reminded of that as we stand and proclaim together our faith, the faith that we declare as it is written in the Apostles' Creed. I invite you, you will stand with me, and we declare this faith together. And then also, let me just encourage you, if you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, there's a question about that. Waiting to the end is not the best advice. The end is judgment. That's the reason why the Bible says that now is the day of salvation. Now is the day. So as you sense the Spirit of God at work in your heart, and you say, this is truth. I need a Savior. I want to know God. And the heart's cry is simply to cry out to God for mercy. I encourage you to do that so that your name will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and that this great day of judgment might also be a great day of joy for you as well. For those of you who are in Christ, please recite with me. Christian, what do you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He arose again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. I encourage you to remain standing as we close our time of joyous hearing, reminding us of these glorious truths that is ours.
joy that we can have through Christ as Lord and Savior. Guide us, bring us back here safely next week as we ask this now in the looking of Jesus' name.
I think it's just a weak voice.